was doing a study to look at the essence of interaction in an online course. And in his study, he came up with some key elements that are important when you're looking at interaction in an online course. For example, if you look at the framework that he developed, interaction is at the center of learning. So interaction is one of the most important components of any learning experience. So if you look at interaction when you're designing your online course, there are elements such as social presence. Social presence has to do with you, the lecturer, how you actually conduct the online course. And this is heavily influenced by your philosophy of teaching. So whenever you're thinking about online interaction, a good starting point is to look at your philosophy as a teacher. What are your thoughts about your presence when it comes to teaching online? How do you conduct your classes? Do you create opportunities for learners to actually interact? And we are going to look at examples of how this can be done. Then we'll also look at the context. In this case, our context is the online learning environment, and this is influenced by how we structure content. And that is why the way you structure your online resources on the online course is very, very important. You're going to see how that impacts on interaction. Then there's the learner support element, the learner control, right? So do you have frameworks within your institution that support learners who are learning online? In that framework for supporting learners online, you look at the learner support model. Do you have technical support available for the students so that when they get stuck, when they're learning online, there's that framework for support that is available? Then there's the pedagogical support, which is given by the lecturer. Then we look at element of feedback. This really falls solely on the lecturer. Are you providing feedback for the learning activities that are taking place? And of course, there's what you call dialogue. Dialogue is that interaction. In the second part, we are going to look at the different types of interactions. If you look at interaction, there's a study that was done by a lady known as Moore. Moore looked at interaction in a classroom environment aspect. There's what you call the student-teacher interaction, the student-content interaction, and then the student-student interaction. But called Hannah Glowacki, who further unpacked the model that Moore divided it into two main categories, what you call human interaction and non-human interaction. So within your online course, what is human interaction? Human interaction is the student-teacher interaction and student-student interaction. When you're developing the online course, you're going to develop learning activities. And these particular learning activities are going to trigger student-teacher interaction. How is this going to be done? For example, when you give students an assignment, that assignment requires the teacher to give feedback. That is student-teacher interaction. When you initiate a discussion forum or a discussion topic within the discussions, then you as a teacher are supposed to give feedback to the students. That is student-teacher interaction. But then again, there's also what you call student-student interaction. How can this be achieved? You can develop learning activities where students give feedback to each other. That is what you call student-student. So you can give them a discussion topic. And in that discussion topic, you can ask the students to comment to another student's post. That is student-student interaction. Then there's another level which I thought of adding, which is very, very important. This one was drawn from an experience I had when I was helping a lecturer in South Africa develop a HIV course. Within the course, the lecturer developed a topic whereby there was going to be a guest expert who was going to give a small webinar on the trends of HIV in South Africa. So to make your course richer and more so in the direction we are taking, whereby we are looking at competency-based approaches, where we want learners to have a real-world experience to what we are teaching, you can have sessions where you're not only facilitating, but you're also inviting guest experts to give opinions to the students or give a webinar session within your course. So student-guest expert interaction. That makes the course very rich and very tangible in terms of the outcomes of the course. Let's look at the non-human interaction. These are student-tool interaction. Remember, we are on a learning management system that has tools. This is a platform. It is a technology. The technology will have tools such as the discussion forum. It will have tools such as the blog. It will have tools, many, many tools, including this particular tool we are using, which is a web conferencing tool. So when you are designing your course, can you have a look at what tools are available on the platform? Then the tools should be able to help you develop interaction. Then there's always the student content interaction. This is when the student is interacting with the content that you have developed for the online course. And here, we on the platform, we recommend use a variety of different content types. Remember, we have different types of learners. We have visual learners, we have auditory learners, and we have kinesthetic learners. We're going to look at that in the next slide. So take care of the various types of learners that you have in your course by varying the content types. Now, when I look at the student tool and student environment aspects of the interaction, your technical team should be able to advise you on the environment. For example, there's a tool that is being developed by Moodle community, the H5P. It uses what you call HTML5. So this enables you to create very exciting content, which can even be used for what you call gamification. So you can have games within your content. For example, you can have fill in question after, you can have a questionnaire within your video resource, so that at a given point the student is assessed. You see, so you can put games, interactions within your content using this tool. It's a very valuable tool which the lecturers can be trained on how to go about it. So let's look at another aspect, which is learners and how they learn best in an interactive environment. Now, when learners are in a very engaging interactive environment, these are some of the ways that you can use to make them learn better. Number one, engage in active intentional learning. Active intentional learning, whenever you see the word active, it means participation, involvement. So when you're developing your online course, can you think about developing opportunities for interaction? We will look at how this can be achieved. For example, use a lot of discussions where you ask thought-provoking questions in the forums, and then you give the students an opportunity to actually give their thoughts and opinions. Another way of active intentional learning could be, you can, in the icebreaker activity or the initial activity within your course, you can do a small poll about the student's opinion about a certain concept. Then you can ask them to defend their opinion based on some aspects of the learning materials that you have given them. Okay, so that is active intentional learning. That is one way that learners learn best. The other way is to collaborate with solving problems. Give them scenarios, give them case studies, give them opportunities to brainstorm, solve a problem based on a given theory or a given concept that you have taught them. Then represent knowledge in multiple ways. Don't just give them text-based resources. Variate. You can do a lecture video online. You can actually give them a simulation. So variate your resources. It makes learning exciting. Then participate in real world authentic activities. For example, if I am teaching public health, and right now we have the COVID-19 scenario, you can ask them to simulate something about public health concept using real world authentic activities. If you're teaching economics, you can look at the current situation with the economy, and you can tell them to simulate or to come up with a concept based on the real world authentic activities. This makes learning engaging and it makes it exciting. Then the other way you can actually make your learning or your course to be interactive is give frequent feedback to the students. The students learn best when they receive feedback and it motivates them. And then challenge them to grow and think deeper. For example, whenever I'm supporting a lecturer to develop an online course, at certain instances or points within the course, I ask them to come up with self-reflection questions that enable the learner to think deeply. So after you've given them a note, notes to read or a video to watch, can you give them some self-reflection questions to think about deeply the concepts that they have learned? And then possibly they can write a blog and put it on their personal blog on the platform, which other students can react to, and that brings peer-to-peer learning. Then have access to tools for meaningful learning. Just as I've told you, the technical team should be able to help you identify the available tools on the platform that can be able to trigger exciting interactive learning. Then give them an opportunity to apply what they have learned. In online learning, we use what we call formative assessment and micro learning, whereby students are able, you chunk your content into smaller segments, and within that segment, after you've taught a concept, a segment can satisfy one learning outcome within a topic, then you can give them an opportunity to apply what they have learned. Can they write a report about what they have learned? Can they be able to do what you call role playing, whereby they defend a given position? It's almost like the debates that we used to have in school, but now they're in a digital format where students are now applying what they have learned. They're defending their position. They're telling about a concept that they have learned and trying to present it to other learners. We're going to look at the learning pyramid. The learning pyramid was developed by the National National Research Training, and they're looking at what you call the applied behavioral science. And here they're trying to call the applied behavioral science. And here they're trying to explain how best learners retain knowledge. Now, if you look at the lower end of the pyramid, at 90%, learners retain more knowledge when they teach others. Which means in your course, if you have an opportunity of a lot of peer-to-peer learning, where learners are critiquing each other's work, where learners are being presented with a case scenario and they are told to actually defend that particular case, where they are writing blogs, explaining what they have learned after you have exposed them, of course, to certain resources, you see they are able to retain more. They retain also more when they are practicing, applying the knowledge that they have learned. Discussion also ranks very highly. Okay, and you can see when it comes to the kinesthetic learners, these are learners who learn best by doing. The three aspects of discussions, practicing, and teaching others rank very highly when it comes to the kinesthetic learners. Of course, we have the visual and auditory learners. Okay, the ordinary learners, they just need to hear something and they are good to go. And the visual learners who need to see something. That is why you need to variate content, develop simulations, develop lecture videos, develop multimedia resources. And the technical team should be able to help you achieve this. So whenever you use these approaches of delivery, discussions, practice, and teaching others, or you see the learners are able to retain more. And more so that you're dealing with learners at a distance, who get bored very quickly because they are almost isolated, they are alone, these approaches tend to keep them moving and it reduces the attrition rates. Okay, so in looking at the Bloom's taxonomy, we see that at the knowledge level, reading would do, but now at the lower level, at the higher end, which is create, which is the highest level, we need to move down and do more of the three lower levels of the learning pyramid: discussion, practicing, and teaching others. And actually, this is where we should be zeroing more when we are developing our online course. And the course development framework, which guides the lecturers on how to develop the online courses, should focus more on these areas. Okay, so let's move on to your role as a lecturer when you're teaching an interactive online course. Number one, you need to continuously monitor learning performance frequently and contact learners who are falling behind. So within the LMS, it will be giving you what you call the learning analytics. A learning analytics is how the learning is taking place. When was the last time the lecturer actually accessed the course? What course resources did they access? How did they perform in the assessments or assignments that have been given? The learning analytics enable you to monitor the performance of the student and you're able to follow up the students. That makes the students who are lagging behind become active. Then participate in the online discussions. frequently post in the discussion forums thought-provoking questions. Give the students an opportunity to engage within the discussion forum. You realize that the discussion forum is one of the most powerful tools that you have to actually actualize interactive online learning. Embrace your new teaching role. This has to do with your personal philosophy when it comes to teaching. E-learning will introduce you to a whole new dynamics of how to teach. So as an instructor, you need to embrace this new role and you need to redefine your personal philosophy when it comes to teaching, also with the use of technology. Then teaching online requires more time. This is a fact and it is true. Because of the personalized learning that is introduced. You see, in a class, you can ask a question and only one student will raise up their hands and answer, and then you will proceed on. But in online learning, when you post something in the discussion forum, literally almost all the students will respond to your question. So you will be giving individualized feedback. So truth be told, be psychologically prepared that teaching an online course will be more time consuming. So as a lecturer, you also need now to reorganize yourself to be able to take up this new role, reorganize your time. But then again, this is also time that you'll be spending more on the keyboard on online, right? You can formulate ways of giving individualized feedback and collective feedback to the class. If you look at like the assignment tool, it has features that allow you to do collaborative or group feedback and individualized feedback. So in the lecturer training, you'll be trained on how to use these features of the learning management system that allow you to do the personalized and group feedback. Then provide prompt and specific feedback. That is very, very important. Then check your communication channels daily. Respond to messages within 24 hours. If you do not respond promptly to students, they tend to fall back. They tend to be higher attrition within your online course. So as a lecturer, you must be psychologically prepared that you will be accessing your communication channels a lot. That is the communication tools on the platform, because on the platform, there's a message tool, there's a forum tool, there's a webinar tool. You will be interacting with these tools a lot. There's an email. Some students will be sending you emails and they need feedback. They need to receive and to hear from you. So be psychologically prepared. So as a lecturer, your role in the online learning platform or online learning mode of delivery is also going to be refined. And you need to be psychologically prepared. As I said, the teaching philosophy, your personal teaching philosophy will really have to change to adopt to the new role in interactive online teaching. Now, let's look at a few recommendations that we can make with regard to achieving this interaction. It is advised that lecturers call the online students at least one time during the course. So keep in touch with your students. That will keep them active in the online class. So online students also need the real human interaction with the lecturer. So this tells you, initially, lecturers were afraid that with the introduction of technology, it will make lectures or lecturers redundant. But actually, it is now solidifying the role of the lecturer because your presence is very important in quality online learning. The second recommendation we can make is with regard to the online practice exercises. So when I'm sure that you have developed an online course development framework and which guides the lecturers on how to develop the content. Within the content, within the topics, as you're developing your learning materials, make sure that you put reflection questions, practice questions. You can even do short quizzes after every segment of your content, so that learners can practice. So this keeps the learners active, right? And then as they are practicing, they should also be interacting with other students. So sometimes in the practice exercises, you can have them do it in groups of two or three, where they actually go through the practice materials together, and then they're able to interact, and then they give you the feedback, they give you the output for feedback or sometimes it can be automated into the platform. Like, for example, quizzes, they have the feature for automated feedback so that as soon as a student finishes a quiz, they are given certain feedback based on how they performed. Another recommendation that we can make to make your online class or online learning active is with the use of discussion forums. So in the discussion forums, a few tips that you can use is, number one, submit general feedback in the discussion board or the discussion forum. So here you can, for example, you have given them a question to discuss or a topic to brainstorm in the discussion forum. You can make a summarized feedback to all the learners after they have posted, all of them have posted. Then submit relevant questions asked by one student via, for example, email or in the face-to-face meeting or on the discussion board. For example, you might be teaching this course online and also teaching it face-to-face. So your online students should be able to benefit from the discussions. Oh, you have taught this course for many years and you know the kind of questions that students ask, right? The kind of questions that are prompted. So you can create a discussion forum in the discussion board, which allows students to be able to benefit from that. If you're supervising students teaching research, and you know some of the common frequently asked questions in research, as you're teaching your online course, you can bring those questions in the discussion board to allow students to brainstorm. So you're actually blending the experiences of your learners and bringing the rich experience into the discussion forum. Remember, the discussion forum is one of the most important tools you'll be using. So when a student places a question in the discussion board, it is advised that the lecturer also gives other students opportunity to answer the question. So once a student asks a question, don't be quick to answer. Sometimes allow other students to also tinker around with the question and give their suggested answers. Then maybe towards after 2 or 3 days, you can come in and then you can give feedback. Then it is advised that the lecturer responds after a couple of days, right? Don't always be quick. Just allow the students to tinker around with the discussions. Then you can come in after 2 or 3 days to actually summarize. This is actually very important because as students are posting and interacting in the forum, you're able to see the direction of their discussions. Then you can be able to gauge, have they understood the concept? What do I need to refine more? Possibly, is there a resource that I need to give to the learners to reinforce learning? So you're almost doing like quality assurance as well as teaching. Then there's a type of learning activity which I find very, very useful when it comes to creating an interactive online class, what you call simulations, case studies, and role play. Role play is when you have a discussion activity or you can have a learning activity where a student takes up a given role. For example, you can tell them, assuming you are the governor of Kisumu County and you want to enforce policies that can maybe achieve certain aspects in the county, how would you go about it? Right? So that is a role play activity. Then in the role play, you allow the students maybe to make a presentation in a webinar session like this. So you can set up a webinar session where the students defend their position based on a given role that they were taking up. Case studies is when you use real life examples and you allow the students to check out or pick out certain concepts, which that brings out the level of learning, what you call synthesis, analysis, synthesis, which are higher order and create level in the Bloom's taxonomy. Then there's the simulations where you can simulate a scenario for the learners, and then the learners are supposed to pick out certain concepts from that simulation. So these approaches, simulations, role play, and case studies are very useful when it comes to creating an interactive online course. Now, the final recommendation that you can look at, let me just scroll to the 13th slide. So my screen is not moving. Okay, so we're at number 13. Yes, so the other recommendation is we talked about variating the content types or the course materials. So in this way, let us strive to do recorded lectures so as often as possible. For example, we are having this session and it is being recorded. So you may be having a session like this. Make sure you record it and then you make it part of your learning resources. In this way, students who did not participate in the webinar can still be able to benefit from the learning resources. Remember, in interactive online learning, we do not want to leave any learner behind. All of them must follow through with us. So let's use any available technique to ensure that the learners do not fall back. So that's the end of my presentation. I think we can open up the session for questions and brainstorming, and also we can build the presentation further by bringing in more ideas. So I think we can now, I give it to Dr. Ratemo. You can take questions and then we can be able to brainstorm. Tom.
Hi. Hello. Hi, Barbara. Could I ask a question? I've typed it, but I can't. Yeah, you talked about the recordings, recording a lecture so that we don't leave any student behind, which is really important because, as you've seen, when we started off, the network was playing up. So maybe there's a student, the network played up, and they didn't follow from the beginning of the class, or they were not there for one reason or another. I'm wondering, does the system allow for a filing of this record so that the student can access it at any time? Or does the lecturer carry it for them?
No, the system you're using right now, it allows. So what will happen is it will, after the recording is done, it will attach it as part of the course resources. So yes, the system will store the recordings for you so that when the student comes online, they will be able to access those resources, but all the past recordings.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, so I have seen a question someone was asking about the student tool interaction. Remember, we are going to be using technology tools, and these particular tools are evolving very quickly. We are getting better and high-end tools as the LMS continues to be advanced. So in this case, like for example, you need to understand the tools that are available. I shared with you an example of what you call the H5P. The H5P is a tool that is being developed by the Moodle community so that you're able to create interactive learning resources. So you can have, imagine you can have a game of cards to explain a concept. It's that advanced. You can even have what we call a tour on a given area in a 3D format within your online course. So the student will be interacting with this tool to achieve a certain learning outcome. So that is what I meant by the student tool interaction. For example, like the standard Moodle quizzes with embedded feedback. So you can create very good quizzes and embed feedback within the quizzes. So the student will be interacting with that tool, and the tool will have embedded feedback within it. So that creates what you call a form of the student tool interaction. So it becomes a very important form of interaction, more so now that we are using technology. Someone is asking, how does a lecturer go? That is Dr. Bila. How does a lecturer go about this if the class is big, say 300 students? Now the platform has what you call the groups and grouping within courses. So this allows you to be able to group learners into smaller chunks, say of 40 or 30 students, so that you can have 10 groups of learners within your course. And you can interact with the smaller groups within your course. So that is very, very much possible. It is also, that particular feature allows you to also do what we call the group-based learning activities. So you can have a course whereby you can give each group different projects to work on, and then you can be monitoring the groups within the grouping. So the platform allows you to do what you call groups and grouping, having smaller groups of students within the course, which can easily be monitored. Then Ms. Kemunte asked, is it possible in future to pick content in a topic, then maybe attempt to model it into an online content? Yes, it is very, very much possible. So that practically we can see how best we can make it interactive. Yes, it's very much possible. And I'm sure a part of your team, you have multimedia experts who can enable you to achieve this. I have discovered how I have been doing nothing. It's quite thought-provoking. Thank you, Lillian. Any other question that I've missed out? If I have missed out your question, you can just unmute and then you can narrate it, and then I will be able to answer. Sir Cyprian, you're posting a question.
Hi, Barbara.
Hi, how are you?
Fine, thank you. Thank you for the good presentation. My question probably would assist the e-learning, or the e-learning technical team can respond to this. Now that with the COVID pandemic, this is what has really facilitated the e-learning. While students are in campus, it's easier for them to access the internet. But once outside the campus, it really becomes a challenge. And for me, that has been a challenge, getting all the students in class. Some would say like they don't have enough bundles and the staff. I'm just wondering, how can the e-learning directorate support our students so that we are able to have as many students as possible in class? I'm just borrowing this from some meeting. We were a group of lecturers, and like USIU really facilitated the students in terms of the bundles with Safaricom. I'm just wondering, is there a better way that the students can access the e-learning services?
Yes, there is. There is a short-term approach that can be used. Of course, we know that, Dr. Rose, that with time, internet is becoming affordable with time. But as you're moving in that direction, I noticed that you guys are using a platform called Moodle. Now, Moodle has an option, what you call the Moodle desktop and Moodle mobile. So as an institution, you can invest in a custom Moodle mobile, which is not very expensive to do. The Moodle community does it at around 350,000. You can have a custom Moodle mobile app, both for Android and for the people who are using Apple. Then that particular app allows for offline access of content. So what the students can do is, when they are on campus and they are enrolled in the courses, they can download the courses, right? The content of the courses. And then once it's downloaded on their device, they can be able to access it even when offline. So that even when they are offline, they can still continue learning. Then, when they come into an environment where there is internet, the system will simply sync or upload the content onto the live server. So that is one way that you can strengthen. You can have a custom Moodle mobile app, and then the Moodle desktop, so that students can have offline access of the content, which only syncs or it merges with the server content when they're in a Wi-Fi connection. So that is one way you can do it. But as we appreciate, the cost of data is significantly reducing with time. Yes. I hope I've been able to answer you, Dr. Thanks. Rose.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Then there's Lillian saying automated feedback. I didn't get it clearly. Is it a general or it has to be question specific? I heard you talking about it going on as the students interact with their colleagues. Yes, so when it comes to automated feedback, some of the tools on the platform, for example, the quiz tool, it allows you for the lecturer, you can set questions and put feedback within it. For example, you can give a multiple choice question. And then within the multiple choice questions, if a student gets it right, a certain feedback is provided to them. If a student gets it wrong, a certain feedback is provided. If they get it partially wrong, so it is embedded within the quiz tool that allows you to put feedback. So as you're developing your questions, you'd be thinking about What kind of feedback can students be given in such a question if they get it wrong or right, or in any case they get it partially correct? So feedback, this kind of feedback is usually embedded within the learning management tools, more so the question, the quiz tool, which is really, really used a lot when it comes to assessing. Then as the students are interacting with each other, you can create rubrics. These rubrics will guide the students in terms of how they can grade each other's work. As I indicated, I had an experience in South Africa with a South African lecturer who was developing a health system science course. In that particular course, he was using a lot of peer-to-peer feedback to create interaction. So what he would do is, he would create a scenario for students to engage in terms of peer-peer evaluation, and then provide them with a rubric so that the learners know how to be able to evaluate each other's work. So part of your course development as you're developing your online course will also entail developing rubrics to facilitate peer-to-peer interaction, which is also a very rich form of interaction within the online course. I hope I've answered you, Lillian. Karibu sana, Lillian. Any other question?
Stanley, who are, I can see is offline, but maybe my comment would be that then in this case, for us lecturers, we need a lot of support. Remember, we are not trained in this area. So from your presentation, I'm saying that we need a lot of support from the e-learning, and especially in the course content development.
Yes, instructional design is very, very important. As I always say, you know, having a beautiful technology with no content is like a beautiful girl that can never get married. It'll never make sense. So you're right. The instructional design support becomes very, very important because, as I indicated, the lecturer is at the center of the whole process of making e-learning successful. And that is why I remember the first statement, one of the first statements I made, the personal philosophy about teaching, how you teach. That philosophy will change a lot when it comes to teaching online. Gordon Omar, you're asking about how to share screen. Yes, this particular tool we are using, the big blue button, also allows you to be able to share screen. So there's an option of sharing screen. It's just a simple button you click and you're able to share screen. This is very helpful, more so if you're teaching technology-based courses and you're demonstrating how to use a certain software, maybe to install or configure, or you're teaching networks and you want to show how to configure something. So you can actually share your screen and the students are able to see your screen. So I don't want to share it now because my network is not very strong, but it is very, very much possible using this tool, which we are using, the big blue button. I hope I've answered your question, Gordon. Dr. Rose, would you like to say something?
Hello?
Yes, Gordon.
Yeah, that's very clear. That's very clear. On the issue of content development and more so instructional design, maybe what I can request our faculty, I can see there are many here, they just need to have the content. Then now in the presentation on packaging the content would be very key. So the technical team would be available, but that content to be packaged, the lecturers need to have that content. Then it gets very easy, and we encourage them, anybody with content, we are available to help them. They just need to ensure they have that content, then now we help in packaging for e-learning platform.
That is very, very important. And what we also do, maybe just a recommendation to Gordon and Dr. Ratemo, you can also consider developing a framework which is so easy to follow. It can just be in Word, because sometimes when you tell the lecturer to give content, they'll give it in various forms. But you can have a framework or a like a Word document, a storyboard of some sort that is easy to follow, so that they can actually put content within that context of the storyboard. Then it becomes easy now to translate it into an e-learning course. So possibly maybe you can develop a certain storyboard of some sort to help the lecturers conceptualize, because they already know what they teach. But sometimes it's just a matter of how to package it nicely. They'll need that storyboard framework or course development framework to guide them. Thank you so much, Gordon, for that input. Dr. Ratemo, can I hand it over to you now? Hello? Yes, Dr. Samuel.
I'm not sure whether Dr. Ratemo is still in the house.
So you have to be the deputy now, eh? You can take it over, then you can wrap it up.
Yeah, I think because I can't. Just on behalf of those who are joining, I know some people are late, but I believe the Josec has done the recording. Can you hear me now? Not yet. We can't hear him.
Okay.
I think he's struggling to get in. Let's just wait for him to get in. I think he would be having something just to say. But so far, so good, Barbara. This is really rich content. And I'm sure many would be able to still hear you more on so many aspects. I think you have not even given us 1% of what you ought to have given us. But so far, this is really great presentation. I know you are rich in content. And this is very, very key. This is very key. And we are really happy. You are really holding our hands as we are starting these baby steps. It's good now to learn from the giants. So I'm not sure whether Doc is really struggling to get in. Let me just see. I'll just ask the patience for the members, the class. Don't walk out of the class before we dismiss the class, just shortly. Let me just try to reach him.
What was it? Can you hear me?
Oh God, we can now. I can hear you now.
Okay, fine. Actually, I don't know what happened. I've been following everything, but whenever I try to use my mic, it goes off. So anyway, thank you, Barbara. There's something somebody raised there about numbers. I would just like to add something. Someone talked about having large number of around 300 students and beyond. And my input is some of these tools are quite appropriate for large numbers, like the discussion forum. A chat may require that you get in touch with one particular person at a time, but for discussion forums, large number of students can be engaged, and so those can be exploited when one is engaging large numbers. There is the other aspect that Barbara, you have mentioned of exploiting alternative channels of communication to engage learners, including calling, SMSing, and then use of WhatsApp. That is also very critical. Otherwise, learning on the learner management system can be in isolation and people feel like it is something somewhere in the cloud and they are not able to connect with it. So for tutor support, learner support, and actual instruction, it's good to supplement the activities on the LMS with other channels that exist for communication, so that even students know that this is actually an instructor like any other instructor that we come across every day, especially for distant students. Or for scenarios where the learner is the lecturer is not known to the student before the course commences. Some question to you, Barbara. Barbara?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. Content development is quite a rigorous exercise in order to have quality content and highly interactive. But in some situations like where we find ourselves right now, with every university converting their regular students to online, what is your opinion? in terms of rapid content development? How can content be developed quickly? How can, for instance, lecturers record their videos with their mobile phones and make that available to technical team to upload to the LMS, or them uploading themselves, rather than the traditional content development exercise where this is captured by good cameras and it is edited and so on and so forth? What is your opinion generally to be able to have content quickly in a crisis such as this?
That's a good question, and it's actually something that most universities are grappling with right now. So I'll just share my experience on how I'm doing it, because we're also in that particular dilemma, and I happen to be in technical support. So what I've done is that I have developed, remember, I've kept talking about our course development framework, something that is easy to follow, a storyboard of some sort. So I've developed a simple storyboard for the lecturers that I am handling. Then in that particular simple storyboard, it just gives them a framework of how, what content is required as they are chunking down their content and the kind of resources. And I share examples of learning activities within that particular template. Then I have developed video resources, simple how-to tips for the lecturers, and put it on our platform and enrolled all the lecturers in that space. So instead of just putting text-based resources, I have developed screencasting resources. So for example, showing a lecturer, how do you access your courses? How do you edit the content on your courses? How do you upload resources on your courses? How do you create a quiz? How do you create an assignment? How do you access the students? How do you communicate to the students? So simple how-tos. I've identified the key how-to skills that the lecturers need, and I've developed screencasting videos for them so that they can easily follow up. So that now I am working with them. I share with you the template. You fill up the content. Then you move to the place where you now simply upload your content. Of course, it's not going to be perfect, but it is going to be a good starting point, because the online content development is not a one-off task. It is a continuous process. You will keep refining your resources as you move on. So the how-to guides are really helping for the lecturers. But of course, there are those who need intensive support, because we appreciate that they're not in the same level. There are those who are innovative. They're very quick with technology. And those who are not very quick with technology. So the intensity of supports depends on where you fall within the innovative curve, within the innovative curve, the diffusion of the innovation curve. If you're very innovative, the how-to videos really work quickly for you. But for those who really need a lot of support, we are also at hand to provide that intensive support.
Thank you. And maybe the other aspect is diversity, whereas our framework may be appropriate. Again, diversity of content comes up if a course is mathematics and you are using certain tools like Stack, that might be slightly different.
Yeah, so maybe I can also share some small tip. The other tip that I am using, just sorry for that, is that I have identified simple softwares, open source ones, that lecturers can use. For example, I know most lecturers have a tablet or a smartphone. Within your smartphone, there are simple tools within the Play Store that allow you to do simple videos, very simple and very direct. So I've identified some. And then I do a demonstration for the lecturers on how to do it. Very something that does not take more than 3 steps to actually achieve. So that becomes also very important. For audio lectures, I'm talking about use a support tool such as Audacity. So as a technical team can identify some simple tools which are very easy for the lecturers to catch or to use to develop their simple multimedia.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Barbara. That's very critical. Actually, the model is decentralization of content development to lecturers so that they are able to to generate, to be supported to generate content, so that a lot of content can be developed quickly within a short time and of good quality. Thank you very much. Our faculty members raised this, Dr. Rose. A useful tool to minimize internet bundles, especially for students, because the app can be able to synchronize content, and even if someone, they can still continue using content instead of linking up with the platform and doing the content. And there is the aspect also of subsidized bundles. Other universities are doing that. I think those are some of the aspects those are some of the developments to address the issue of internet access. Maybe we take a few more questions from members of faculty. Any other question from
Dr. Atemo and Barbara, thank you so much for the presentation. This is quite eye-opening. It's an eye-opener for me. And I just want to make a comment on the Play Store and getting guidance on how to probably record our sessions. What I've also seen, like when I'm teaching and I'm looking for material, sometimes I go to people's presentations, and especially what has been put in the YouTube. I don't know whether these are some of the things that can be put in consideration so that you assist us record our classes. But again, I'm wondering, I'm not good in this area. I'm wondering, when I'm conducting a class, can I be able to record at the same time? Or would I need assistance from your side to have this class recorded? And then later on, it can be accessed by other students who missed class. Hello?
I was waiting.
Dr. Rose? Yeah, proceed, Barbara.
Yes.
So I'll just comment on the first question that Dr. Rose
asked. Please proceed.
There's a movement, there's a strong movement on open educational resources, a strong movement on making content accessible and open. And it is really, really being pushed by the Commonwealth of Learning and other organizations. So the use of open educational resources sometimes don't need to really put yourself down to develop all content. You can reuse existing content. So if you go to YouTube and you look at the resource and it is good enough and it allows for sharing, of course you have to make sure that it is shareable, because looking at the license under which it falls, you can actually link it into your own resources. So when you're developing the online course, it doesn't mean you have to do 100% content that you have developed. You can reuse existing content, most of the open educational resources. I think Dr. Ratemo is part of the e-learning discussions where we have the Commonwealth of Learning usually runs webinars more so on this aspect of open educational resources. So maybe he can be sharing the link within your group so that you can be participating, and you'll see the large group of common courses that are available for reuse and resources that are available for reuse. So which will really, really be helpful and make your content development process shorter. I think that's the comment I wanted to make.
Yes, thank you, Barbara. Actually, our next presenter will be from Commonwealth of Learning, and Barbara, I will make sure that you are part of that. Thank you very much.
Hello?
Yes, Deputy Director.
There was this issue, Dr.
Mr. Baba, we can hear you.
Yeah, about